responses. Some of you have little booklets there, and we will be beginning on page 13. On occasion, we skip a page or two, but I'm sure you can follow along. Right after the initial blessing by the priest, with the first intention and peace, let's pray to the Lord. You may sit down at that point. Thank you.
Master, give the blessing.
Let us pray to the Lord.
For favorable weather, for an abundance of the fruits of the earth. the most blessed, glorious Lady, the Mother of God, and ever Virgin Mary, together with all the saints, let us commend ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
was there. Jesus also was invited to the wedding with his disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now there were 6 stone water jars there for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 15 or 25 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast." So they took it. When the master of the feast tasted the water, now become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when people have drunk freely, then the poor wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." This is the first of his signs Jesus did at Cana in Galilee, and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him.
Thank you. in Fatima, in Lourdes, and others, do whatever he tells you. With these apparitions, Mary continues to demonstrate her motherly concern for our well-being, but not a concern for our earthly well-being as in kind, not whether or not we have some good wine to enjoy, but rather our concern for our eternal well-being, that when we would experience the joys of the heavenly kingdom. Do whatever he tells you. Observe the teachings which Jesus gave to you. Today, we are celebrating the feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe, the patroness of the unborn. And on this occasion, it is worthwhile for us to consider why the Church is so strongly pro-life. Why we are constantly holding pro-life demonstrations and engaging in other pro-life endeavors. And the answer to this is to be found in the book of Genesis, in the story about the creation of man. And granted, there is no specific pro-life declaration or commandment in that story. But in that story, there is a reason why we must be pro-life. In that Genesis story, we read, God said, let us make man in our own image, in the likeness of ourselves. God fashioned man of dust from the soil. Then he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and thus man became a living being. So man and woman are made in the image of God. However, God did not create the birds, the animals, and the fish in his image. He simply said, let the earth produce every kind of living creature, cattle, reptiles, and every kind of wild beast. And so it was. And equally important is the second statement. He breathed into his nostrils a breath of life. Now, in the ancient Semitic language, breath signifies life. So the meaning here is that God's breath is God's life. But God did not breathe the breath of life into the animals when he created them. He simply said, let the earth produce every kind of living creature. So the life which Adam and Eve received is God's life. And this life, God's life, is passed on to all of Adam and Eve's descendants. This life is passed on to each one of us. And this, by the way, is why Jesus taught us to pray, our Father who art in heaven. Because God is our Father, not in a symbolic or a metaphorical sense, but in a real sense. So it is not animal life that is within us, as many like to argue. It is God's life. And because human life is God's life, then it is sacred. And because it is sacred, it is not for us, but for God to decide how long the earthly existence of any life will last and when it will return to him. This is why any individual person's decision to terminate a life, whether that life has existed for a week, a month, or 5 months, 80, 90, or 100 years, is a disruption of God's plans. It is a rejection of God's will. It is a rejection of God. And this is why being pro-life is being respectful of the sacredness of human life and humble acceptance of God's will. In the name of the Father,